So what is myelofibrosis, which is what we're here to talk about today, right? Myelofibrosis is one of the MPNs, a myeloproliferative neoplasm, and a very personal topic for me. I've lived with an MPN for nearly 30 years, originally diagnosed with essential thrombocythemia, or ET, at age 38 while I was raising two young boys. When an aspirin a day was stopped because I developed an ulcer, I ended up with clots in my portal and splenic veins. After a week in the hospital, I was then put on an anticoagulant or a blood thinner. So several years later, my bone marrow flipped a proverbial switch, and instead of producing too many platelets, it now produced too many red blood cells. The diagnosis was changed to polycythemia vera. And I lived with periodic phlebotomies and daily hydroxyurea, and that was just a part of my life, as it is to many people who live with polycythemia vera and the different MPNs. So fast forward to 2018 when I had surgery for early colon cancer, and the surgeon was very focused on avoiding any more clots. So instead I had the opposite happen, and that was a major bleeding episode that put me in the ICU for nearly a week, followed by several months of healing. It was then that I finally sought out an MPN specialist. I began to see Dr. Ellen Ritchie. She's at Weill Cornell in New York, where I had an updated bone marrow biopsy and confirmed diagnosis of myelofibrosis. So I used to say it was mostly asymptomatic, but in fact, I've lived with severe migraines, a few TIAs, and other constitutional symptoms my whole life. It wasn't until I was taken off hydroxyurea before starting a clinical trial that I realized just how severe my symptoms were without treatment. I had had both life-threatening clots and bleeding episodes, and now I had such extreme fatigue that I couldn't walk up the street without stopping to lean or to sit on a neighbor's step. Of course, I also know how fortunate I am, as many people suffer so much more than I ever have with any of these diseases, with some of these chronic blood conditions. But in particular, we're talking today about myelofibrosis. So with that, let's just dig right in. And Dr. Fleischman, exactly what is myelofibrosis?
Okay, so the word myelofibrosis, people may interpret that as having some fibrosis in the bone marrow. What we're talking about today is the myeloproliferative neoplasm myelofibrosis, which also can have some fibrosis in the bone marrow, but want to emphasize that fibrosis in the bone marrow does not always equal myelofibrosis. With the MPN myelofibrosis, it's a chronic blood cancer, which stems from the proliferation of some abnormal mutant cells in the bone marrow. Exactly what causes the fibrosis in the MPN myelofibrosis is unclear. The abnormal megakaryocytes, or those are the cells that are producing platelets, have been implicated as the sort of the bad cells in myelofibrosis and causing the fibrosis. Part of myelofibrosis is not only the fibrosis in the bone marrow, but patients tend to also have an enlarged spleen, which can also be seen in ET and PV, but is more prevalent in myelofibrosis. Also, patients with myelofibrosis, their blood counts can look very different in terms of there's a wide variety of what a myelofibrosis patient's blood counts look like, but a classic myelofibrosis patient may have some anemia, they may have a little bit of a high white blood cell count, they may also have some cells that are called immature cells in their blood. So their bone marrow cells are not maturing fully before they go into the blood, just indicating that there's some stress going on in the bone marrow. And also myelofibrosis patients can have some significant constitutional symptoms. ET and PV can also, but in myelofibrosis, they tend to be more severe. But I do want to emphasize that just because somebody has a bone marrow biopsy that says fibrosis does not necessarily always equal the MPN myelofibrosis. Other things like autoimmune diseases can cause some fibrosis in the marrow. Infections can cause fibrosis in the marrow. Other blood cancers can cause fibrosis in the marrow. So what I want to emphasize is fibrosis does not always equal the word MPN myelofibrosis.
That's a really good reminder and not something that people focus on much. So thank you for that. The world of MPNs, as we know, in particular myelofibrosis, is changing before our eyes, right? As clinicians, researchers, and people living with these conditions. Dr. Mesa, would you tell us how the landscape of treatments for MF patients has changed so dramatically just in the last 2 to 3 years?
Well, thank you so much, Ruth. So during my career, I saw patients with myelofibrosis first in the beginning of my training, now almost 30 years ago. You know, in the first half of those 30 years, you know, the medicines we had for myelofibrosis were really limited because we had a very limited understanding of the biology of the disease. What happened about 15 years ago is that we identified important genetic changes, such as the JAK2, calreticulin, MPL, and others, that are important changes in genes that lead downstream to a patient having a myeloproliferative neoplasm. And with that, we've really seen an explosion in many different types of therapies that have been tried to really make an impact. Over the last 3 years, we've seen a rapid increase, really first in FDA-approved options that we're going to go into in a moment, which are now 4 different drugs that are inhibitors of the JAK2. And they've made a real impact for patients with myelofibrosis regarding enlargement of the spleen, symptoms, perhaps helping to slow down the course of the disease to some degree, and some individuals even really dramatically so. And then the next step, which we're really launching into, are now combinations of therapies where we use more than one drug, sometimes looking at treating different aspects of the disease or different targets in terms of the biology of the disease to make a deeper impact. Indeed, as wearing my cancer center hat, as I look at how therapies are advancing in many different diseases, both blood cancers, you know, as well as non-blood cancers, you know, most of the time we're now using more than one therapy in ways that these medicines complement each other to treat the disease. You know, different blood diseases such as multiple myeloma, now they're using up to 4 different drugs at a time to try to treat these diseases. So the explosion has been, we went from really very little understanding to now multiple drugs, a much greater understanding of the biology of the disease, and hopefully deeper and deeper impact.